The following is a non-verdict-based research versus show. The stats of the individual characters are not taken into consideration when determining aspects of the fight. However, the characters themselves are going to be represented in their fullest capacity outside of stats.
This is versus universe. The dynamic duo. A trope as old as time, especially in music. I mean, you got Simon and Garfunkel, Hall and Oates, me and also me. But on the comedic side of things, musical duos are incredibly rare. Except for these two. And Flight of the Conchords, but fuck 'em! It's a battle of acoustics and electronics, of old and new, of Tenacious D and Ninja Sex Party. Let's begin!
Fucking time ago, in a town called Kickapoo, I lived a humble family, religious through and through. But yeah, there was a black sheep, and he knew just what to do. His name was Young JB, and he refused to step in line. A vision he did see, a fucking rocking all the time. He wrote a tasty jam, and all the planets did align.
Fed up with his religious family's ways, Jables was left to lament in his room after a vicious beating from his dad. That is, until he got a calling from Dio, may he rest in peace. A spark arose in the young lad. He took his father's money and ran away from Missouri, going from Hollywood to Hollywood in search of his destined partner, as foretold to him. After many years of searching, on his trip to Hollywood, California, he met a busker, Kyle Gass. KG's golden fingers spoke to JB, and they improvised a song right on the spot, one that the crowd seemed to enjoy. Noticing the talent in the younger musician, Kyle took Jables under his wing and taught him the ways of the rocker, cuck push-ups, the power slide, and of course, gig simulation. But in the process, JB's prized possession of his shitty acoustic guitar was broken beyond repair, and to top it all off, Kyle was lying about having hair. End of his general success as a musician, but mostly the hair. Now realizing they were more similar than anyone could possibly imagine, Kyle revealed something to Jack. His own personal, actually good, acoustic guitar with his initials decorating the instrument. Now set out on the path of bandom, they would need a name. Luckily, they both revealed a secret birthmark on their ass cheeks, and as Lee, the number one fan of the duo, looked on from his seat, he couldn't help but notice that if you put them together, you get the greatest combination of letters known to mankind in this generation or the next. Tenacious D. The D are a most unusual pair of musicians. They claim to be the greatest rock band in the world, but they clearly lack a lot of the fundamentals of rock and roll. I mean, you can have acoustic guitar in rock, but it shouldn't really be the only thing. Instead, their sheer love for music and rock permeates in all of their songs, even if they don't have an actual rhythm section. And I mean, honestly, if it wasn't somebody like the Antichrist, it would just slow them down. Now without a source of revenue, the duo had but one mission laid out before them, the quest to get Kyle's rent. After attending an opening mic night with Paul F. Tompkins hosting, he talked the two into competing in a battle of the bands, with just enough prize money to break even. Although, JB was visibly unhappy with this, as he also heard a rumor, about the pick of destiny. And so, the duo trekked all over LA, in Lee's car that they totally didn't steal from him, in pursuit of this mystical artifact. And along the way, they learned the ancient secrets of its powers. For you see, the Pick of Destiny is a fragment of Satan himself, extracted when a powerful wizard fucking broke it off or something and banished Lucy back to hell, where he undoubtedly belongs. And so, through harnessing the powers of hell itself, the two would be able to absolutely crush anyone who opposed them at the Battle of the Bands. Unfortunately, when they actually got the thing, it split into two parts, rendering it effectively useless. That allowed Paul F. Tompkins to reveal his true identity to the world. Satan. Now recompleted, the D were forced into a tough challenge to compete against Satan in a rock-off. After all, the demon code prevents him from declining them. And I mean, they did pretty good. But this is the devil we're talking about. He kinda fucked their asses. But unfortunately for him, JB's new guitar managed to deflect a lightning bolt meant for Kage, and it struck his horn, repeating the words of the wizard.
From whence you came, you shall remain until you are complete again.
JB sent the devil back to hell, where he presumably resides to this day. With their journey over and a friendship formed, the two did one last thing. They converted the devil's horn to the Bong of Destiny, took a fat rip, and started making an album. I suppose now was as good a time as any to really go into detail about how a Tenacious D song is composed. So as a way of exemplifying this, I made a virtual copy of myself and placed them in the real world. Take it away, real world Skye.
I cannot believe I exist for such an inane purpose. I exist only to explain things on Versus Universe. Why can't Narrator me just do this?
It saves on the edit, idiot. If you prefer, I can just erase you from existence?
Nah. I'm good, actually. What do I need to do, anyway, huh?
All you need to do is explain how Tenacious D works musically.
Oh. I've actually been wanting to do this. At least for my existence, I guess.
Yeah, you're very welcome. Just get this over with. I still have the extended lore of the D to go over.
Fuck off! Anyway. Tenacious D can be divided into essentially two parts. Folk and rock. The folk comes from the two guys on guitars thing, but the rock comes from a lot of the progressions they use on their guitars. Not to say they won't use folk progressions as often they do, but it's more like Jack will layer on rock-inspired vocals over Kyle's more folk-inspired playing. Just listen to this part of Beelzebub to see what I'm talking about.
Wait, you motherfucker.
Now the backbone of Tenacious D is this.
The acoustic guitar.
Kyle tends not to shine his lead guitar parts, instead opting to tastily and sensibly back up JB's more intense vocal stylings. The resulting mesh is something to really commend, as their unique musicalities clash so that they both can coexist in a sort of heightened state because of each other. And all this gets exemplified more when they're joined with a full band, and Kyle's playing becomes the backbone of an entire rhythm section. Of course, I can't go without mentioning their rhythm section, which consists of the Antichrist on guitar, there's Charlie Chaplin on bass, and then there's Colonel Sanders on drums. They better know. Don't ask about it. I'll kill you.
On their quest to write an album and pay the rent, the duo also went through tremendous personal growth. They learned to not take each other for granted after Kyle quit the band for a week. That with karate, they can indeed kick your ass from here to Tiananmen Square. And that they could remember what song they wrote to defeat the devil, so they just wrote a new one. Don't worry, this one is just a tribute. Wait, didn't they do that already? On September 25th, 2001, the world was graced with the D's first album, simply titled Tenacious D. It had around 15 songs recorded, with a backing rhythm section. A first for the D at this time. Oh, right, we still need to go over the timeline of the D. Let's do that now, shall we? So chronologically, The Pick of Destiny, the origin story of the D, takes place first in the timeline, but it is not the first piece of D media to exist in the world. That honor, officially, goes to the television series, which we've just briefly went over because it's much more episodic than the movie essentially acting more like a live-action cartoon than anything notable. So in 1997, they filmed this TV series with 6 episodes, and by 2000, all the episodes have aired. Around this time, Jack had gained popularity thanks to his role in High Fidelity, and so it only made sense to capitalize on both his and the D's rise in power to create an album featuring many of the songs they performed on the TV show, but this time with a backing band and not just the 2 on acoustic guitar. Though, honestly, it's not like it's a downgrade to simply have the guitar by itself. But, Skye, you must be asking, why on God's green earth are you even fucking talking about this? You're supposed to be here for a Vonnie Versus analysis, you fucker, you fucking dick! What happened to it? Well, this is where I think a lot of you hop off and never come back to me, because now, dear viewer, we have reached the divide. Now, the divide is a bit of a high concept, so let me break it down for you as simply as I can. There are 2 versions of Tenacious D. On one hand, there is the real band, Jack Black and Kyle Gass. These 2 have known each other since the 80s and been best friends ever since, and have played to countless arenas around the world, elucidating the world in their tasty-ass jams. They record with Dave Grohl, John Spiker, and John Konecki, and their albums hit platinum. On the other, there is the fictitious band, JB and KG, Jables and Rage Kage. We've already been over their origin. So, which is the truth? Well, really, it's a mix of both. The next step in the world of the D does involve the fictional D, but also the real one. For you see, The Pick of Destiny was not a hit, critically or financially. So much so that the band essentially did a press tour and didn't do much of anything else from 2007 to 2012. Sure, they'd perform, but they weren't really there, you know? Then, all of a sudden, they realize something. All they would need is another hit. A top 10 hit, a top 40 hit, or hell, a top 1,000 hit. And luckily, they found it. With the rise of the Phoenix. Get it? It's like a penis. The D was back in action, baby! And honestly, from here on out, there hasn't even been a moment where they weren't doing something. Even in between their 3rd and 4th albums, they managed to stay relevant through live performances and covers, as well as Jack starring in more films. Thanks Kung Fu Panda, the duo started work on their 4th and so far, final album. On their never-ending quest to pay the rent, this time they jumped the shark. The duo got hit with a nuclear bomb and hid in a refrigerator. This is Tenacious D in post-apocalypto. Through roaming the wastelands, the 2 of them came across many people. A 2-headed doggy named Hope, a group of women called the Cave Bear Women that gave them both blowies, Elon Musk, who is kind of not a great person, and of course, a robot that came from the future, equipped with a robo-pussy. Now they had a mission, to get the Crystal of Gilgamesh from Washington, D.C., which is being controlled by the KKK and Donald Trump Jr., and take it to Egypt. This was set up from the future by Jables Jr., Jack's own son, who built the Terminator. But as it turns out, JB Jr. resented his father for never being there, and so he plotted to have the duo retrieve the crystal for him and rule over the entire universe. Even the robot had turned on them, given how he was built by JB Jr. That is, until the woman that fucked them all that time ago showed up to save them from their imminent demise, and all was right within the world. Except, you know, JB Jr. was there as a baby, and him also being there as an old guy, meant that the rifts of the space-time continuum would collapse in on themselves and reset to the nearest branch in the timeline. The decision of the D to go out and jump the shark. Or that it was a dream, I don't really know. Aliens are there, so I guess it'll happen. But really, the thing we need to know is what about their rent? Well, it just so happened that Timmy Nader and his dog Hope came knocking on their door as Timmy is their landlord. Taking this as a sign, the duo invited Timmy to jam with them as a way of paying off their rent. And so concludes the story of the fictional D. The real one are currently at work on the new album, aiming to release it in 2024. But in the real or fake world, none have rocked my fucking socks off while remaining some of the best friends and role models a musician can ask for other than Tenacious D. Oh, and it's defense. The D stands for defense.
Are you with me?
Totally.
Power up.
In the suburbia of New Jersey in the late 1980s, there was a Jewish boy destined for greatness, Sir Daniel Sexbang. Danny had but one goal in mind, to become a member of the greatest ninja slash sex themed band in history. But there was a problem. He wasn't a ninja, nor did he ever do the nasty deed before. Luckily, he could easily remedy at least one of these things. The ninja thing. He killed a king, which, like, altered the course of European history. It was kind of a big deal. On the opposite side of the country, there was a boy. A boy named Brian. He had a similar dream, to be a great musician and start a band that would conquer the world. Except, he also really fucking likes to murder people. Like, that's his whole thing. I cannot stress enough how much this man loves murder. Then, one thing led to another, and one day in New York City, the two managed to bump into each other. One thing led to another, and then they both realized something. They share the same dream. To murder European royalty? Well, that too. But mainly to start a band. Brian, now Ninja Brian, and Danny Sexbang started a piano-based rock comedy duo band. This is the birth of Ninja Sex Party. Now, they both have their own vices, but their music is usually about one of two things. Sex or murder. There's far more about the former than the latter, so let's go over that right now. Danny Sexbang, believe it or not, is a pretty sexual guy. Now, you may think that this means, he does a wacky shenanigan and that off-puts the girl he's hitting on, but, like, that only happens sometimes. Sometimes. Sometimes! Okay, so, look, his game isn't the best. That's fine. It's not like he doesn't pull, but it takes a bit. Especially how it can only last 3 minutes, and will cry before, during, and after. And at the sheer mention of sex. Okay, maybe this guy isn't so much of a Chad, but he is, indubitably, without a shadow of a doubt, really attractive. To some. But that only leaves murder, which, unlike Danny having sex, is something Brian actually does. A lot. So much, in fact, that it often gets in the way of when Danny's trying to woo a lady back into his parents' house. Or just their lives in general. I mean, he killed everyone at Danny's birthday party. It was so moving, he fucking cried. That's a low blow, Brian. Oh, wait, shit, fuck. I mean, that was really cool, actually. Yeah, the notion of the fourth wall doesn't really mean anything to these guys. I'm just lucky I cloned myself like 20 times in the last week. Otherwise, this analysis would have gone down the toilet very fast. Anyway, whenever they aren't dealing with boning or homicide in any sense of the word, they're often having to deal with supernatural entities, like the Manticore. He fucked my dad. Odin. He gave Danny the ability to shoot lightning out of his balls. And of course, demons. Who they share cookies with? Holy shit, are those demons consuming him? Who cares? The varying stories the band has underwent over the years has dictated that they undertake varying genres in each of their songs. So once again, Real World Skye, take it away!
Again. This is so stupid. Anyway, Ninja Sex Party as a band takes inspiration from a number of places, but most prominent is their way of taking 80s synth pop and making it something more comedic. Not to say they don't branch out, of course they do, this is just their primary style they ride in. Now, with a backing band, their styles increase to a general rock and, coolly enough, funk. But this all hinges on one important thing, the instrumental. And that is something that Enja Brian, historically, is the one to write. Danny's there to tell jokes, be sexy, sing his fucking heart out, but Brian, he's the real mastermind behind these compositions. Brian is also a classically trained musician, so a lot of the times he'll use music theory tricks that would go unnoticed by those not in the know-how. But not me, Brian.
I notice.
These progressions are implemented with one key instrument. The piano.
What?
Basically every single song NSB has done has implemented the piano or synthesizer in some way, shape, or form because it's just that versatile. This is the backbone of everything NSB does, and Danny's voice is the cherry on top of that cake of foundation. Of course, piano isn't much of anything without a backing rhythm section. And while Brian used to do this himself by programming music to play alongside his piano, nowadays they have the boys of Tupperware Remix Party to help them out. Now, twerp is really its own can of worms, and one you should definitely check out because all their music is really cool and nice and positive, so I'm just going to keep this brief. So, essentially everyone in twerp is an instrumentalist. Lurch Phobos plays the electric guitar, Commander Meowch plays the electric bass, Hav Hogan plays the drums, and Dr. Sung plays the keyboards. When combined with Inja Sex Party, they become a double keyboard sextuplet band with amazing rock power. Dr. Sung also plays the talkbox, which is this little machine that will take a signal from any instrument, including a keyboard, and push it out into this little tube. Then you put that in your mouth, and you can sing with it. Isn't that neat? You just learned something about music, chump. Deal with it. With twerp by their sides, they've had even more adventures, including that one time Danny ruled a medieval kingdom and decided to release a kraken that sounded a lot like someone who has a PhD. Dan went on a date that ended poorly. Not due to the mergers this time, that's a positive change. And of course, they were summoned by a king in another dimension to kill Markiplier. But their biggest adventure by far was one that encapsulates everything NSP is about. This is 6969. Through his expert engineering skills, what? Danny managed to build a spaceship. This spaceship can also travel through time, and Dan had one specific point in time he wanted to visit. 6969. With a sexy core set for the sexiest year, the duo arrived in, oh god, it's 2020. Human touch is outlawed. Everybody just waves at each other. They're all wearing turtlenecks. Oh, maybe this joke is a stretch. But you know what's not stretching? Dan's penis. And he's pissed about it. So he went to the cock geriatrics. the dick elders. And complained to them about the lack of boning in this dystopian nightmare. But they had a forewarning that a sex-crazed Jewish man dressed in blue spandex and a ninja donning black would crash their historical hierarchy. And so, the duo returned to their spaceship after getting chased out by those fucking stupid elders. Then, Dan saw someone. A woman. Who he immediately fell in love with. Then, in a rare move for Danny, they fucked. And fucked. They fucked a lot, is what I'm saying. And suddenly, a multi-person orgy had broken out all across the globe. Wait, why is Markiplier there? They killed him! This is bullshit. And then, the shackles of the dick elders were broken all across the planet Earth. And they were pissed about it. They tried to put an end to Danny's fun, but Brian wasn't having any of it. Using his years of murdering experience, he killed their entire regime in one nanosecond and truly set the people of 6969 free. Now, having done their civic duty of dismantling a corrupt governmental system, Danny and his girl, Karen, said their goodbyes to each other. And so, Danny Sexbang and Ninja Brian rode off into space, thus concluding their adventures in the year of 6969. Where they are now, nobody truly knows. But one thing is for certain, when they are needed, they will come to rock yours and my heads off. Whether with Danny Sexcapades or Brian's homicide, they aren't going to be stopping anytime soon. And that's the important thing to remember about an SP. They're doing what they love. And they didn't start until Danny was in his 30s and Brian was in his 40s. So, it's never too late to follow your dreams. And ultimately, what better message is there than to do what you love? I know I do. And you should too.
Rock fuck!
Sorry. I couldn't help myself.
We open to a shot of Jack and Kyle's shitty apartment. Jack has just walked in the door, and Kyle is fast asleep on the couch.
Dude. Dude!
What? What is it?
Dude, we need to pay the rent.
Oh shit, we do. Yeah, how are we gonna do it this time?
Glad you asked. I just saw a fly around the hallway. Battle of the Bands. 10,000 big ones just for getting in the top 10.
Oh, that's convenient. So, where is it?
That's the tricky part. It's in space.
Did you just say space?
Yeah, bro. Space. We gotta do some major traveling if we want to get up there.
Maybe try talking to Elon Musk?
No, Elon won't talk to me after I fucked his wife. Also, I'm pretty sure he's dead.
Damn. Oh, maybe we should ask our neighbors.
Not a bad plan, Gage. Let's get to it.
The duo visit many of their neighbors before coming to door 101, and, as they knock, a face familiar to our viewers comes to answer the door.
Oh, hey, neighbors. How's it going?
Gage, we need to sidebar.
All right. I guess.
Okay, guess I'll just stand here while you two talk about me behind my back.
Do you really think we can trust this guy?
Jables, we've tried everybody else in the building. These guys have the biggest apartment here. They might be hiding a secret spaceship.
Okay, but counterpoint, that guy lives with a fucking ninja!
Just then, Ninja Brian appears suddenly between Kyle and Jack, holding a knife.
I don't see a problem with that, Jack.
Ninja Brian then walks back into his apartment, standing silently next to Danny for a few seconds before retreating into his home.
Ninja Brian tells me you guys need a spaceship.
Oh yes, please, do you have one?
Yeah, we have one. We don't really use it either. What do you need it for?
Oh, we just need the money for—
Nothing. We're going to network. Get the tale of Tenacious D into the cosmos.
JB, what are you doing?
Trust me, Cage, it's the only way.
Well, we're a band too. Maybe we should compete. Right, Ninja Brian?
Brian just looks at Danny unblinkingly, not changing any motions in his body, except to slowly lower the newspaper he was reading down from his face to look unobstructed at Danny's face.
I knew I could count on you. We're going to space.
Wait. Cage, we're gonna need our full rock power if we're going to stand a chance. We need our rhythm section.
Aren't they all in hell?
Yeah, but the Antichrist gave me this phone to call him in times of need. I haven't called it, not since we got out, but now is the time!
Alright, give him a ring!
Okay. Okay, hold up, okay? It's going to voicemail. Fuck me, fucking cockass!
Leave him a voicemail.
Leave him a voicemail, that's you. That's what you sound like, whatever. Hey, AC, it's JB. We need you and your crew in space right fucking now. The future of Tenacious D depends on it. And sent.
You know, we should probably get our guys too. Ninja Brian, send a messenger pigeon to Dr. Sung of Twerp, and he's already sending him a text message. Yeah, that's probably more effective.
Alright, let's go to space!
Yeah!
We then see all the musicians on NSP's ship they used to travel to 6969, clearly in need of repair. As they make their way to the venue where they'd both perform, they notice that they'll need to sign in at a tiny plastic desk with a line longer than the surface area of the United States. Everyone gets in line, and then Ninja Brian kills everyone that is not Tenacious D or Ninja Sex Party.
Gotta say, murder is helpful.
I know, right?
It has its ups and downs.
We then see the two separate bands in two separate green rooms. On the left side of the massive stadium where they'd perform lied Tenacious D. On the right side, Ninja Sex Party. In precisely 9 space minutes, the two bands would face down with each other on opposing stages, separated by a giant crowd. We then peer into Tenacious D's green room.
All right, Cage. Do you have it?
Yeah, of course. Why wouldn't I?
The Bong of Destiny. I need you now more than ever. Antichrist still hasn't shown up and I'm freaking out over here, dude. Freaking out!
Okay. Oh my god, that is good shit.
Give me that. Oh my god. You were right. Oh, you're so right. Even if we don't get the rhythm section, we don't need them. We got the rocket sauce.
Yeah, let's rock, Jables.
Let's go, Rage Kage. Bring the thunder.
We then cut away to Ninja Sex Party's green room, with Danny similarly freaking out.
Warp, those guys are always on time! I swear to God, if they can't make this because of their stupid day job, I'm cutting ties with them. Who even needs the Starlight Brigade?
Ninja Brian does nothing.
I know they help everyone in the universe, Ninja Brian, but can't they spare a minute to help us? They're friends! Oh great, we're up in 3 space minutes! This is gonna be a disaster!
We then fast forward those 3 space minutes to both Tenacious D and Ninja Sex Party entering their respective stages. Both only armed with their 2 original members. Kyle and Jack both have their acoustic guitars, and Brian with his electronic keyboard. Then, simultaneously, the pits of hell open beneath Tenacious D to summon the Antichrist on electric guitar, Charlie Chaplin on bass, and Colonel Sanders on drums.
You guys came. I'm not gonna cry, I'm not.
Stop. Got your voicemail.
I love you, Antichrist!
I love you too, JB.
Alright. Eyes on the prize. Let's do this!
On Ninja Sex Party's own stage, Twerp's own spaceships land behind the duo, complete with their instruments. Dr. Sung on keys, Lord Phobos on guitar, Commander Miach on bass, and, of course, Have Hogan on drums.
Oh, thank God you guys came! I wouldn't know what to do without you.
Yeah, it's cool. We can only do one song, though.
One song is all we'll need. Let's do this!
Then, a voice comes over the PA that sounds suspiciously like me, the narrator. The competition will be divided into 2 parts, individual and battle. In individual, we will need individual performances of one song, and the battle will be you all playing over a previously agreed upon song. The individual portion shall start with Tenacious D. You may now begin.
All right, Kyle, let's do this.
Yeah!
Don't you fucking blow it, Cage.
I won't?
Let's rock their fucking socks off!
A long ass fucking time ago, as written in the scroll, a kick-ass acoustic duo would come and rock your soul. The world's most awesome band would come to rock this scene, and that band's fucking name is Tenacious D. Whoa. Six, six, six. D's back, we're in fucking space to shoot goo all over your face. You may have seen us rocking on Earth, but it's time we give the space stadium the what's worth. My name is Jack, his name is Kyle. We know you're rocking you all the while. His golden fingers shall steal the show. Go kaboom with Explosivo. And this will be my plan of voice. To make up a 39-year-old woman voice. I'll fuck you up in men's bed. I'll make you bust when I bust in a scare.
Ninja Sex Party shall commence their song.
All right, Ninja Brian, let's do this! You always know what to say to get to me.
As time has come near and far to the edge of our reality, a great search was made for two great men, Ninja Brian and me. And so we took a rocket ship and flew to outer space. And now we're here to musically kick you in the face.
Now I know what a lot of you are thinking. Are you really going to narrate your journey to the battle of the bands in song form? And the answer.
Started with a knock on the door, with a duo longing for more. They crossed a painted path. No one was safe from their rightful wrath.
I'm building with Tenacious D. I'm singing so happily. I murdered a thousand guys so that we could skip in line. In the green pit, freaking out. And get on stage, there is no doubt. All my friends are there to show.
Shoveling his fingers, buddy. world, that's all we hope to do.
And that concludes the single song portion. Now, you both will compete.
Not so fast, motherfuckers!
Oh my god! It would appear that Satan himself has approached the ongoing rock-off to interject. Let's see what happens.
You two!
He can't be talking about us.
He can't.
It's an impossibility.
Literally, improbably, not us.
You motherfuckers knocked off my fucking horn! I've come to reclaim what was mine, and I brought a little entourage for your new friends!
My god! Brian, it's the Samurai Abstinence Patrol! Quick, allow me to summon the power of Odin with my testicles, and you've killed them both with little effort. I guess Satan is out of your wheelhouse.
Shit, Cage. The Bong of Destiny. That's right, Jack Black. And now, you're gonna fucking die.
Not so fast, Lucy.
The fuck is it, Cage? I'm in the middle of something.
Us, Tenacious D, and Ninja Sex Party both challenge you to a rock-off.
A rock-off within a rock-off? Rockception!
Well, shit. You know I can't decline this. Let's get this over with. Hey, announcer!
Yes?
You'll be the judge. Now, Samurai Abstinence Patrol, your souls shall rock as hard as they fucking can, so I can get these fucking losers' asses back to fucking Earth.
All right, Satan. You start. Then, D/NSP, you go. I shall determine the winner.
And if I win, I'm taking Cage and Brian back to hell.
For the first time since getting here, Ninja Brian looks serious. Shit is about to go down.
Satan is back, back in the ring. Here to kick ass and also fucking sing. You two had left me broken and scorn. Now I'm back cause I have my fucking horn. It would seem to me a meeting here was destiny. Fate against all odds might be the work of some higher god. Who cares about me right now? It's all about rock and roll. And KG and Ninja Brian, I'm gonna steal your soul. The trio of your nightmares has been made real. And every mouth gets on, bury our drums, and me record the steel. With all our powers combined, there's no way that we can win. So am I, my friend. The pits are so low, can now begin! That's impressive. Let me show you something. Choke on that, Chodes!
Don't listen to him. Listen to me. Everyone, we can do this. All we need to do is banish him back to hell. I've done it before. I can do it again.
All right. In the meantime, let's blow this stupid demon down.
Let's go!
We came to this place to rock and roll.
And enlighten all your rock star souls.
We'll beat the devil, of that there is no dispute.
So for one last time, let's do a tribute.
Let's go!
Come on, Kage, Danny, and Brian, let's send this fucker home. Shall we freeze what was written in my soul?
Let's take this world to places they've never been. Don't forget to explore with the
by my side, we can conquer the world.
Here I am, crying. I promised I wouldn't get emotional. Ninja Brian, hand me a tissue. I was thinking about sex.
Wait, Danny, look. Two beautiful women.
What's your name?
What?
Abigail. Well, Aubrey, this one goes out to you.
1, 2, 1, 2, 5, 6, 6, 6. We are the world's most awesome band. Standing together, hand in hand. With our strength combined, there's nothing we can do. And that includes me. Like you, we are the world's most awesome band. Standing together, hand in hand, with a strength combined, there's nothing we can do. That includes beating demons like you. From whence you came, you shall remain. Until you are complete again.
Wow. I can't believe we beat the devil. Again.
Yeah, this is a first for us. Still basking in the glory.
Attention, please! Given that these weird men in their 40s have banished Satan, despite them only competing against themselves, we have elected to make them a member of the top 10, and therefore eligible for the cash prize!
We did it! Yes! Yes! In your fucking face! Yes! Where's the rest of my body?
It is then revealed that Ninja Brian has murdered everyone except for Danny, and Jack's floating head, severed from the rest of his body, floats gently downwards, suspiciously lacking any blood.
Ninja Brian, what did I say about murdering new friends? Oh, I can't stay mad at you. Oh, you have stabbed me in the chest. Yep, I'm dying. Yep, yep. Goodbye.
Ninja Brian looks directly at the viewer, and thus concludes the tale of how Tenacious D and Ninja Sex Party came to meet and understand each other.
So, I know some of you are pretty upset, but hear me out. This show has never been about traditional versus ideas. I mean, did you guys
watch the analyses? That's a trick question. I know you don't. You just skip to the fights and see there isn't any animation, so you click off the video. But if you did, you may have noticed. I never brought up anything traditionally versus related. Because, well, that's not why this matchup interested me. I did this because I have a love for these two bands, and wanted to share that love with the world through my own means, not through copying what a traditional versus show would do. And besides, I think having a battle of the band style showdown is way cooler than Danny Sexbang kicking Jack Black in the balls. Although that would be pretty funny. Maybe I should rewrite this episode. Sorry. That clone had to be put down. They were getting a little spicy. Anyway, I don't really have much else to say. I hope you enjoy Versus Universe Season 2 so far, and look forward to the next episode. Speaking of, I think I made a trailer for that. Wait, I definitely did. Here it is.
Bye.